Okay, everybody, welcome to this month's book club meeting for the Firefighter Book Club, and just a couple of announcements. I think about 7 or 8 months ago, we had Brad Mayhew on here. He covered his book Origins, which actually talks about the Yarnell Hill Fire. Brad was the lead investigator on the Yarnell Hill Fire. He's actually going to be coming to Red Helmet Training in Southern California next month. So if you want to get a plane ticket, come to SoCal, come find me. And see Brad present, let me know, DM me or send me an email, and I'll get you an invite to that. During that same week, we also have Mike Snodgrass coming out and doing FireX Talk, 20-minute talks on fire, kind of like a TED Talk thing. He's going to bring his entire camera crew down here to Red Helmet Training, and a lot of cool stuff has come out of fire talks. Bo Davis and Cody Tresdale and all those guys, that's kind of where they hit the national platform. So if you're interested in coming out and doing a FireX talk, let me know, send me an email. For the next month's Firefighter Book Club meeting, we're going to be covering Burnt Around the Edges by Arjuna George out of Canada. Really cool book. I've kind of started getting into it. It starts to get into actually surviving stress in the fire service and how to try to master those things and keep from getting to burnout. So really interested in it. I definitely am a person that probably needs to read this to keep myself from getting into burnout with the training company and all that. So really looking forward to next month's book. And then May, I'm trying to nail down Coralie Moore to talk about the 9 L's. Between our schedules, I think we're missing the date. So go back to the reading list for 2023, keep figuring out what books we're doing next. And I'll try to like start sending that out a little earlier so you have a little bit more time. Okay, so for this month, we're meeting with Chief Scott Thompson from the Colony Fire Department, and we're discussing his book, The Functional Fire Company, and great read for me. I got hooked right at the beginning. The intro from Brian Brush kind of like suckered me in right at the beginning, so I was really excited about that, but let's welcome on Chief Thompson.
Thank you. Glad to be on.
Thank you, sir. Actually, right at the beginning, like I said, the intro from Brian Brush, there was a sentence that caught me, even though it's not your writing, but I think that it leads a lot to what's going in the book. And I posted this on one of the things on Facebook, introing this book, was Brian says, imagine the possibilities if an organization trusted its people as much as complete strangers do. If we as an organization empower our people, we trust them to do what's, you know, and we walk into people's houses and stuff like that. So I think that was a great sentence from Brian and leading to a lot of what we talked about is that mutual trust and respect and everything else. So anything you want to tag on with Brian's line there to get started?
No, you know, same thing. I didn't know Brian very well when I asked him to do it. I just, you know, I saw some of his work and kind of shared the philosophy with him and just real excited. But I think, I think that highlights a lot of things that I kind of talk about in the book as far as culture and valuing those types of things and the level of service that we want to deliver. So yeah, it was a great match and he did a fantastic job and it was just a true honor to have him be a part of the project.
Yeah. Brian's very dynamic and I always love listening and watching what Brian's doing next. So as when you were writing this, how did this all come about where you're taking what you're doing and literally demonstrating leadership and showing what leadership looks like within your department? But how did it actually become a book?
So I always kind of wanted to write a book. It's always kind of been a goal of mine and just never really was able to get it to a point where it was something manageable that I could focus on. And then going to work in the colony in 2009, and I won't spend a ton of time on it, but in 2009, the colony was kind of referred to as a hole in the donut. We have a lot of very well-funded progressive fire departments all around us, Plano, Frisco, Carrollton, Louisville. I retired from Louisville actually. And so a lot of neat things were just really going on. We had a very low turnover rate, even when we were one of the lower paid departments and our equipment was very subpar. Nobody was leaving the organization. And so we were having some of these successes without really a huge financial backing. And then in 2015, Warren Buffett and Berkshire Hathaway came in and invested in our city. And then the change was just the craziest thing that I've ever experienced in my almost 40 years in the fire service. And so with all that going on, the things that we did just to meet the demand and stay relevant in our own community, just all these little stories and things started to pop up and just cool things that we were doing to address problems. And so kind of started to look at that and refine it and develop an outline. And once we, the book originally was going to be titled Fire Service Success, The Basics. And that was kind of the original goal. And I couldn't really make that work. That was way too broad. And so when I started focusing on the fire company and a culture and high performance fire companies, it really started to make sense. But I had three reasons that I always kind of share. One, I had a message that I wanted to share. I've worked for some iconic fire service leaders over the years who taught me a lot of things. I only have a bachelor's degree, and it's a, you know, I need to probably get my master's, but I made the decision to write the book as my master's degree instead of doing the same amount of reading and writing papers and getting a degree. But I'm also severely dyslexic, and so this was a huge mental exercise for me. So that's kind of how it came about. And like I say, it's something I've always wanted to do, but the colony project was really when things started to make sense.
Yeah. Well, it's amazing that you even talk about the dyslexia. Like, I didn't know until we had Burton Clark on here covering his book. And he's going through that same thing. And I sent him a copy of my book, and he goes, "Jesse, I won't read it. It's very tough for me to do it." But I wrote the book, and so it's pretty amazing. Like, it becomes a kind of a thing to help you go through that process. So who would have known, right?
Yeah, yeah.
With that, there's one of the things you talk about in there where this kind of just came to fruition, where you just started realizing that really to change the culture, you had to get it all the way down to the company level, like you talked about, right? So how do you actually dig into the culture from the chief's, 30,000 foot view? How are you viewing the culture when you first came in, and how are you actually managing the culture as you go?
Well, I'm not one of those fire chiefs that stay at the 30,000 view. I like to be more hands-on, and not in a micromanagement sense. I still love the job and really like being involved in things. But I kind of took a shortcut when I got to the colony. This is the sixth organization that I've worked for. I worked in Plano, Louisville, Arlington, Texas. And so I kind of took a shortcut when I got in the colony. I wrote something which at the time I titled The Excellent Vision and Professional Standards. And what I did, I went around to the firehouses and I listened to what, this is when I was new, visited and asked the members kind of what they wanted. And I listened to that. And then I spent each weekend just kind of purging my brain and putting all down on paper. And I gave it to my shift commanders. And I said, this is, do what you want with this. This isn't a policy. This isn't a procedure. This is a tool to help you understand my vision of the suburban fire service success and what I think success looks like. And so it kind of started there, but the focus was really on committing to a chosen culture. That was the first step. And we call it a high performance learning culture. And so I really wanted to see if this vision could become a reality. And the way to do that was really through chasing this chosen culture. And in doing that, we identified that the subcultures and the microcultures and how to make all these complement one another so that we're all moving in the same direction. You know, you've probably in your travels and your experiences, you know, you hear pretty commonly, if you have three shifts and 10 stations, you'll say, oh, we got 30 ways of doing things. Well, I didn't want that. I'm very passionate, and probably one of my pet peeves is we're the Colony Fire Department. We're going to come off the truck in a uniform manner so that everybody gets the same level of service. And that really starts with the culture and what the culture values. So I've just always kind of been a student of it. I really didn't recognize it as culture in my early days. You know, I guess I just kind of looked at it as the environment. But that's really where it kind of started. And then when we did the Colony project, and we kind of tore the organization apart in order to understand why we were having the successes we were having, why we weren't as successful in other areas, we looked at our formal influences, our informal influences, which is culture, opportunities and ideas, and then threats. It became very clear what these, what the organizational culture, the subcultures, and the microcultures were kind of valuing. So that's kind of where it started. And that was really why we were having the successes that we were then. And even to this day, I just did a presentation at lunch for the Chamber of Commerce here. And they asked me, you know, what are some of the most important things in my world? And I say, I manage a culture daily. That's one of the things I do. I don't believe there's anything more important than the culture. I'm just a huge student of it, a fan of it. I study it and I try to be a practitioner as far as that's concerned. And so it's just something that's really just become my world, if you will, as far as a leader in a suburban fire department organization.
Well, and you can tell going through your book that there's a lot of research behind it. You're digging into a lot of different managerial books and, you know, and part of it, you talk about the climate versus the culture. Like, what's the difference between climate and culture when you look at it?
So I'm going to even add something to that. I'm going to start with morale. Well, I'm even going to go before that. So in society, there's normative behavior, right? That's our rules when we go outside of our house. You know, it's why we don't run around naked, because that's taboo in normative behavior. So that's kind of the benchmark. And then from there, you have morale, right? And that's kind of that's the thing that's the most obvious and is probably the most volatile in any organization. I mean, one week the morale can be great. And the next week, everybody's saying, oh, the morale's never been this low. And then the next level is climate. And the climate, to me, the way that I look at it and the people that I have studied, it's kind of a snapshot of the organizational culture at any point in time. So when you're working with culture, you want to look for signs and symptoms if the culture is healthy or if it's maybe becoming unhealthy or even toxic. And so by understanding those various levels, it helps you to identify rather quickly when things are either going in the direction that we want them to go in or they're starting to deviate from that chosen culture. And with that understanding, we can take action quickly before it becomes an institutional problem. So morale is the easiest thing to really identify and correct. The culture is a little more complex and a little more difficult. It certainly takes a longer period of time to modify it. And so that's kind of how I looked at it is the climate to me is just kind of one of those vital signs, if you will, of the organizational culture.
Yeah, and I think a lot of times with that morale, it's that difference between the motivation factors versus the maintenance factors. A lot of times it's one of the things I had in my book is we were getting low on money, as we usually do, that you go through the budget cycles and everything else. And our fire chief came to us at small department that I worked for prior. And he said, for the last 2 months of this budget cycle, we are completely out of money. Like, I've moved all the money over to payroll. We're doing what we can. You know, it's just been a rough year. And he asked all of us, he said, hey, would you mind for the next 2 months bringing in dish soap and laundry soap and toilet paper and whatever, just to like,
oh, get really?
It was probably really humbling for that chief to ask us to even do that. And of course, at that time, we're all like, no problem, chief, we'll take care of it, you know, and for 2 months, we're using Charmin instead of the sandpaper we usually have and Tide and, you know, real soap. But the crazy thing is 2 months later, the budget gets renewed and now we're buying new extrication equipment and everybody's all pissed off because it's like, well, we were just bringing in our own stuff, you know, 6 weeks ago. Right. And I said, look, it's one of those things that if you go to the fire station, you go to the firehouse and there's toilet paper on the roll, it doesn't motivate you to be a good firefighter, but if there's not toilet paper on that roll, it's going to quickly demotivate you, right? So when you start looking at that climate and what you're talking about with the culture, I think that the coolest thing when you start talking about leadership, like, hey, this is the way we're going, defining that way, I think that you've taken culture and put it into almost an SOP format to show them, like, well, this is what we want the culture to look like. Brunicini talked about, I wish we would have had a little bit more SOPs on how we do customer service. And we were getting there, but I think that's the coolest thing as I'm reading your book is it's like, you can let the culture run you, or you can run the culture by showing them what we want it to look like.
And you're exactly the right. Every organization has a culture. If two people come together and stay together for any period of time, they're going to have a culture, the things they value basically. And yeah, so you're right on the money. So you can either accept the culture that's going to exist and hope it's a healthy one, or you can pursue a chosen culture and move in that direction. And there's three cultural drivers that I kind of focus on. One is leadership. The next is the social norms of the organization, basically the day-to-day behaviors. And then the third is kind of the work design, how we do things and our operational philosophy and guidelines and how we deploy. And I think in the fire service, whenever somebody talks about culture, they're talking about one of those three things. And it can be discussed as morale, as climate, or as describing the culture.
Well, and even that, you can tell that there was that time that you spent as a training officer, even in Louisville under Rick Lasky and all that. But you can tell that you're leading the culture of training all the way from your seat as well, right?
Yeah. Yeah. You know, if I don't value it, I can't expect the men and women of the organization to value it. There's a few things that I put out there, not a lot of things, but the fact that we're going to be consistent on how we deploy, the fact that we're going to train, and I say quality daily training, not quantity. I'm not worried about how many hours we log a year. You know, we're not chasing ISO 1 and like that. I want it to be quality. We're going to train on things that are going to help our people be successful when they go out the door. And so we kind of package it like that. And when you do that, then there is something for the culture to value in the subcultures and the microcultures. A lot of it has to do with how you package it, how you communicate it to the organization and how they're going to understand it.
Yeah, I know a lot of times as an instructor, I'm trying to get to that effective domain of learning. I can get to the cognitive, I can get to the psychomotor, but really getting them to understand why is it important to me, that's going to really pay the dividends on when they're going out to train and why they want to go out.
You got to make it personal. You got to make that why me connection. And we all expect that. You know, I laugh at these salty guys who say, oh, I hate it, you know, when the new guy asks me why. Well, we all want to know why, you know. And when we understand the why, we kind of become problem solvers. And so that's critically important. And I think certainly as leaders, we owe that to the men and women that look to us for leadership, is to explain the why and how it impacts them on a personal level. The days of saying because I said so are long past. If you want your employees to be engaged and to buy in the things we're trying to do.
Yeah. Well, I think even when it comes down to training, you end up with training officers, training coordinators, you know, those types of things where they're just managing training and keeping it moving along, like you said. And then you have those training officers, they're there for a reason. I mean, me personally, I got trapped in a garage on a wildland fire 16 years ago. And it's the reason why I'm heavily involved in training today. And it's like you said, the training was personal. And for me now, it's personal to keep me coming home to my family every single day and making that change. So,
but if I want it to be important to the entire organization as a fire chief, as a battalion chief or a shift commander, right? If we don't value it, we can't expect the men and women that look to us for that leadership influence to buy into it. It doesn't work that way.
Right. Talk about some of the training stuff that you guys are doing there. I kind of like hit, the line of duty death stuff that you're doing, the personal, the Monday morning quarterback. Can you expand on any of those things that you're doing?
So one of the things that we started doing a few years ago is we were trying to find a way to bring continuity to our training. You know, my experiences in the past, and I started to think about this and address this while I was in Louisville. I was also the training officer in Arlington, Texas, which was much bigger. So to get this continuity, and so I don't know if you read, but we started something called a training season. And we're finishing up spring training. And so every year in the month of March, we're going to address the basics. We're gonna stretch lines, throw ladders, work on our firefighter rescue and survival drills, and they're gonna be taught by senior firemen. So, you know, when you talk about learning and retention, the science, the stuff that I've read says, you know, as time passes, obviously your knowledge and your skills begin to deteriorate. Well, what is an acceptable amount of time to let go by before we revisit those basics? So we do that every month of March. As we come out of the month of March, we'll start what we call our training season, and that'll go from April to September. And that's where we go back to company level training. The company officers, with the assistance of our training officer, we'll focus on engine company stuff, truck company stuff, And really, that's where we do the big five in the first 5 minutes, and the line of duty death, the Mayday, all those things. And then as we head into our fall classic or our playoffs, that's where we start to do our battalion drills. And that's where we test our operational coordination, our communication models. We start out at the technique level, and we graduate to the strategic level. And then when the fall classic's over in November, then that's where we do kind of all our odds and ends. That's where we do our HR training, our step up training, our promotional preparation. And we start planning for our next training season, which will come around in March. And we start it all over again. So we're visiting the basics every year, and we have continuity to our training. It all feeds off of one another. We're not just taking this shotgun approach of we're talking about wildland fires this week and commercial buildings this week and high rise this week. And while that's all valuable, it's all drilling is always valuable as long as the content is accurate. I wanted this continuity. And so we've been doing this training season. It's worked really well for us. But the big five in the first 5 minutes are the foundation of our company level training.
Yeah. And it seems like a lot of training officers, they just kind of that ebb and the flow. We're starting to get where we're hitting the basics really hard. And then everybody's like, oh, we're always just doing the basics. And then we start doing something advanced. And then we do that for like a year. And then they're like, man, we need to get back to the basics. And then we'll do that for a while. And we just keep going back and forth. And so I think it's good to like, hey, there's a time to focus. And like you said, the repetition, one of the things you talk about in the R's, you know, mm-hmm. There's certain skills that we need to have that repetition and be good at throughout the career. Even if you've thrown ladders 100 times, and I'm a big philosophy of training in the streets, going and finding a place, throw ladders somewhere else. I can go to any fire station in the country and say, that's probably where you throw ladders at this station. It's flat. There's no rain gutters. There's nothing to damage. You know, there's a concrete divot, you know.
But you make a good point. And that goes back to the chief supporting it. Now, I can be a chief that says, oh, no, we're not going to pull our ladders off the rig because that's going to delay our response time and we're going to break stuff and blah, 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 blah. Right. That's going to discourage training. I guess about 2 or 3 years ago on Facebook, I was out at our shop and there was like 20 ladders up against this pole, all various sizes. And I went to my EVT, my emergency vehicle technician. I said, Brandon, what are those? He goes, oh, those are all ladders that we need to fix that are not going to pass the certification test. And there's two ways I could have responded to that, right? I could have said, oh, this is unacceptable. This is going to cost us too much money. Let's stop doing ladder training. I chose another approach. I congratulated the organization. I said, thank you for damaging these ladders because I know the blood, sweat, and tear. I mean, it was done by hard work. It wasn't done because of neglect or horsing around or anything. I mean, our guys were throwing ladders constantly. And because of that, the ladders got tore up and we were throwing them a lot on fires also. And so that's part of that philosophy, if you will, on how the chief can either support or deter, you know, quality daily training.
Now, coming into this, right, we're blending the training and the culture together. I mean, obviously, when you first got there, was there some pushback? Was there some naysaying or was it?
Yeah, I mean, I think there always is when a chief comes in from the outside, you know, everybody's kind of feeling everybody out and they want to see how serious are you about these things. Is it going to be the project of the week and you're going to forget about it? And so, yeah, there was a learning curve and I had to stay pretty consistent and be involved. I was much, much more involved in training when I first got here than I am today. I mean, I would teach classes during spring training. I'd teach a lot of firefighters, the stuff I taught at FDIC. And all that. And so, when I got here, I had 3 shift commanders, and they all had 30 plus years, great guys. And they basically ran the organization back then. And so I was messing with their turf, with what they were comfortable with. And so we had to work through that. And, you know, some of them decided to leave, to retire. They just didn't want to put forth that effort or felt like they were going to be left behind and become irrelevant. So I would say there was more of kind of just a learning curve and a look to see if this was going to be something that we were going to stick with and not keep changing directions versus just a flat out. I mean, I had one of my shift commanders who blatantly said, yeah, we're not doing that. I found that out after the fact. So, yeah, we had some of that. But I think today it manages itself. I mean, I think the company officers and the senior men and women and the shift commanders, They're driving it now, and we do a lot of cool things. I mean, a lot of times we're training two or three times a day when we're not making calls. We're doing an EMS drill, and we're doing a fire quick drill, and then we're maybe going out to the yard and doing some hands-on stuff. And, you know, they're 45 minutes, 30 to 45 minutes to an hour. We're not beating our guys up with 4 hours worth of training, and it just works really well for us. The formula works well.
Yeah. Well, I think I saw it on like Crew First Culture with Jeremy. I think you talked about that a lot of the officers that you're promoting at this time don't know anything different. Like that's the only right. culture they know. And and it just becomes the norm. If you get to, you can go anywhere. And if you get to the point where it's like, hey, we train on Sundays, and this is a department that does not train on Sundays, it's God's day, whatever. Eventually, if you hold that line, that becomes the norm. And it's like, okay, we're training on Sundays. That's what we do.
That's just what we do, right? And you go and you do it, and you knock it out, and you go do something else. And that's kind of where we are. You know, I share a firehouse with Engine Company 11 and the battalion chief. And 7 o'clock, I come in, the guys are, you know, they're checking out the gear. They're putting the gear on. They're forcing a door. They're stretching a line. And they're just kind of getting their head in the game and getting ready to make sure that the stuff that they're going to have to use to possibly save somebody's life or their own life, they're intimately familiar with it. It's not going to be, oh gosh, you know, the stretch didn't go well, and it's because the shift prior didn't load it back the right way, right? We're not making excuses. We're trying to be proactive. And one of my priorities is for us to be mentally, physically, mechanically, and procedurally prepared. And that's probably paramount and the most important thing in our day-to-day operation, and almost to a point where if we're not prepared in those four areas, we're not in the best position to go out the door and serve the public.
Yeah. Well, and it's like you said, it's one of those things, we're putting the fire department back in the fire department again. You know, even though we're EMS focused in a lot of areas, you're definitely making sure that the majority of the time is hitting the fire training and doing that. So one of the things I want to talk about, how long did it take from when you came in to where the colony project started, when you started formalizing what we're going to do and how that came around?
Probably 3 years after I was here, when we started to have talk about our city was going to change. That was part of it. But the other part of it was out of sustainability. Like I said, we were one of the lower paid departments. Our equipment was substandard, and we weren't losing people to other fire departments. And so as our leadership team wanted to look at that, because, you know, we could do one stupid thing and that could all change overnight. I could give you a list of fire departments that 10 years ago, they were the department that everybody wanted to work for. And today nobody wants to work for them. And really the only thing that changed was the chief, right? So I wanted to understand where our successes were coming from so that I didn't mess with that. And we were getting ready to build two firehouses very, very close together, which means we were going to hire 30 plus people. And in an organization our size, that's a big deal. That's hiring a third of our organization. And so we had to have a very in-depth understanding of everything that influenced our organization. Number one, so we could sell ourselves, we could sell our culture, and hopefully attract like-minded people. So today, the only people we hire are people that want to train. We don't have a problem bringing in people because they know just from our reputation and any research they do that if they come here, they're going to train. So we attract people that like to train. We have a very strict engine and truck company deployment model. We hire people who that's what they like. They want to get really good at engine work and really good at truck work. Now, is that for everybody? No, absolutely not. It works in the colony, but it's helping us attract the kind of people that we want to attract, and they stay because there's nobody really offering them a better deal as far as what they want from a work environment and what their vision of being a firefighter is all about.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing that you take them out and train with them, and it's going to create a culture that they want to come work for. I mean, sometimes as that company officer, you're like, oh, they're gonna cry about it. I'm gonna make them go out and train. It's like, no, I'm not making them go out and train. They want to go train. All you gotta do is give them the opportunity. And
I say, if you let firemen be firemen, firefighters be firefighters, they'll do some great things. But the fire service has a history of trying to go out and hire the best firefighters they can, firefighter paramedics. And then as soon as we get them in the organization, we start to make them something else. We start saying things like, oh, fires are down and we're an EMS department that occasionally goes to fires. And all those things are demotivators for somebody who's passionate about being a firefighter. Do we have to go to EMS calls? Absolutely. But I'm not going to steal your identity from you. I'm going to let you play out your vision of what this job should be about.
Yeah. So one of the things that you did in your research is you looked at, well, what does success look like in the fire service, right? And you talked about, well, what does the firefighter want? What does the city manager want? What are the elected? So how did that come about where you're like, okay, we got to look at outside our own realm as far as what we want to be successful. What actually makes us successful in everybody else's eyes? What were some of the things when you were going out and looking at that, that really like piqued your interest to look outside the box on what success looked like?
One of the things that irritates me to this day are the fire chiefs who sit in their empire. They're empire builders. All they want to do is buy and build. And it's all based on only their impression or their personal emotional opinion of what they think that fire department should be. That's a very selfish attitude. I work for the public, right? I'm here to serve the citizens. So if I want to hit that mark, I got to go out and find out what my citizens expect from their fire department. So to me, I think that's something that every fire chief should do is go out and say, hey, what do you expect from your fire department? And not just go to a fire chief's conference and talk amongst my peers and we decide what we want to do. And that's where this whole risk acceptance versus risk avoidance come in. So, you know, as I started to see the change coming to our city, and I knew that we were going to change very rapidly, and we were going to have to move in a direction and we were going to have to invest a lot of money in the organization. Let's make sure that we're representing the people that are going to pay that bill. I went out to a Kroger's, which is one of our grocery stores. And I just asked our citizens, what do you expect from your fire department? And I think it's very clear what their expectations are. They'll certainly let you know when you're not meeting their expectations. Right. And so I just think that when, you know, you start to implement change, that's just a huge ace to have in your hand when you can go before your city council and your city manager and say, hey, we want to do this because we heard from our citizens that these things are important. So we're making this decision, not because this is what the fire chief wants in his empire, but it's because what our citizens want the fire department. And it's worked very, very well for us. I'm not sure I exactly answered your question. Maybe I missed some parts, but that's kind of, you know, including the whole picture. But I don't think any fire chief has the authority to make that decision on their own. You know, let's just talk about clean cabs for a minute. And it's an example. I'm not going to get into against. But if I want to expand our capabilities, if I want to hire firefighters, if I want to build a firehouse, if I want to buy a fire truck, I got to go before the governing body and I've got to ask to do that and they have to approve it, right? Well, I think the same thing should apply if I'm going to reduce our level of service. Now, you know, there's that argument, but I believe that clean cabs take seconds away from our deployment. So should I not have to go to the governing body of the people and say, hey, here's what I want to do because firefighter cancer is what it is. We're going to go to this clean cab. And to do this, we're going to add years to our firefighters' lives possibly, but we're also going to add seconds to our zero impact period, the time from when we set the parking brake and go to work. And should they not have the same level of say when we decrease our capabilities? I believe they do. A lot of people will disagree with that. So it's just kind of this whole approach of saying, hey, we're here to serve the citizens. And if we're going to do that, we need to know what they expect.
Yeah. Well, and Bruno would talk about that all the time, right? Really, when you look at, well, what does the customer want? They want quick response. They want standard actions that, you know, and
they want professional problem solvers.
Right. Yeah.
And that's not hard, but it's you got to swallow your ego and you got to be willing to deal with what you hear. You know, it's like when you form a committee and you ask a committee to spec out your apparatus and then you ignore everything that they say, right? That committee's, they've checked out. Right. And so if you want your citizens to really believe that their fire department has got their best interest, which we all want that, then we need to ask them what that looks like.
Well, and it's again, when I say like, look, to my crew, we're going to go out and train in the streets and we're going to go out and see business owners. We're going to go out and the customers are, you know, hey, is the grocery store on fire? No, we're out training. And oh, I just thought you guys sat and played cards all day. But it also gives us an opportunity to find out what the community wants. You can't figure that out by sitting in the brown chairs and having the bay doors closed, you know. And sometimes with that post 9/11 world, man, we locked ourselves in the firehouse a little bit too much. And I think we're losing that touch. I remember, you know, we're starting to slowly get back. 9/11 did it once, COVID did it again. But unless you're going out and having dinner at the Elks Lodge with the engine crew down there or something, how are you going to know what the community expects from your organization?
And the other thing you got to think about is firefighter shows, regardless how realistic they are or not, there's two or three on a week. So, you know, whether you're watching Chicago Fire or Station 19 or what's the new one, Wildfire Country or whatever they are, they're sending a message every week on what the fire, they're creating a reality of what the fire service should look like, right? That we learn a lot from TV. And so that plays into it also. And so we've got to adjust that whole reality thing. And part of it is educating our people to make sure that their expectations are realistic. But yeah, all the things you said, they want us there quickly. They want professional problem solvers. They want us to be nice and courteous, which comes right from Bruno. I'm a huge fan of Chief Brunicini, and a lot of his leadership philosophy is in my leadership soul. And so if we don't ask, well, what are we, it's defining that vision of success. What are we working towards every day? You know, if we don't include the people that are paying our bill.
Yeah. Well, and even in the intro for my book, for the Strategy and Tactics for Employee Fires book, I actually, in the intro, talk about the title change of my book as well, became Rescue Me. And I intro it that I grew up early on as a company officer watching that show and watching them respond to emergency incidents and thinking as a new captain, well, what would I do if I responded to that? And then what would I do if I responded to that fire? Well, then eventually I started looking at the real fires that go on in the firehouse. And I started, oh, how would I deal with that? And how would I deal with that? And it got to the point where I didn't even know how to deal with a lot of the stuff they were dealing with on that show. But I grew up watching Johnny and Roy and responding on Squad 51. I never remembered Marco sleeping with Chet's wife and all that kind of stuff. And it's not that it wasn't happening back then, but as an organization, as a culture and everything else, all of that is open now. And as a fire service, trying to contain that, keep it within our organization where that stuff doesn't happen, that's all part of the culture. So you're not only talking about that. And I know in your book, it's like, look, everything we do is preventable, not only out on the fire scene, but in the firehouse as well. It's, if it's predictable and preventable, a little double G stuff, right?
Right. And he was a heavy influence in the book. And yeah, exactly. Right.
So when you talk about, I lost my place here. So we kind of brought it up, right? The six R's. That's one of the things that you've been pushing out there, not only in the book, but through your teachings, right? Can you go real quick over the six R's, and then I'll turn it over to anybody else if they got something too?
So, you know, another thing that we don't do a great job of is doing a needs assessment before we do training, right? If you're not teaching a lesson and then going out and seeing the level of understanding, if you just bring somebody down to the training field and say, okay, everybody stage here, that's a five-story structure fire, go. And there's no instruction prior to that, right? That's kind of a needs assessment. That's not really. So I wanted a way to evaluate what training is needed and how well is our training doing. So if you look at the model, there's an experience level and there's kind of a knowledge. So the first is recognition. And I believe, you know, there's some application for that. Building construction, reading the smoke, placards on hazardous materials, reading an EKG, right? But that's a very basic level of understanding. The next part is repetition. What are the things that we want our people to be able to do at a very high level of proficiency over and over again? That's where the big five come from. Is in ours, it's hose, ladders, search, protective clothing to involve our thermal imager, portable radio, and BA, and then firefighter rescue and survival, right? And then I'm jumping around a little bit to hit the highlight ones, but then there's rehearsal, which is the the reality connection, like you say, you know, you're getting out on the street, and I borrowed that term from the dress rehearsal from the theater, where we make everything as realistic as possible, and we go out and train under those conditions. Mm-hmm. Then there's recital, and that's a really cool one. You know, you really want to test somebody's level of understanding. You know, you go to a structure fire, a pin job, or even a cardiac event, and you say, why did you do what you did? Well, most time you're gonna say, well, that's just what we always do. But if I can say, oh, well, I was the firefighter on the first in engine, and I know my job was to address fire attack, and because I've been in that neighborhood before, I know there's a 60-foot setback, and that these homes are 2,500 square foot, and based on the pre-arrival information, I realize that a 200-foot, inch and three-quarter flow and 160 gallons per minute would be sufficient. I still have enough hose to get into the attic if it extends up there. I have a great understanding of the job, right? And so by asking that question once, now every time I go to that, I'm not just thinking about the physical aspect of it, I'm thinking about the mental aspect. And if you look at how like the Blue Angels prepare for a show and all that, these mental models are hugely important. If it's not right in the head, it's not going to be right at the hands. And then the highest level of training, there's a review level in there, but the highest level is redirection. And that's to where we have a system that everybody understands what we're supposed to do, what success looks like. But more importantly, when they see that things are not going the way that they should, they have the courage to say, whoa, it's that whole crew resource management thing. Whoa, time out. This thing is coming off the rails. Let's stop chasing a bad plan. Let's stop. Let's regroup. Let's go through these R's again and get back on track so that we're taking control of the situation and it's not taking control of us. So it's just a model that I kind of created that went through what I believe are the various levels of fire service training that I have experienced over the years, and using those to gauge, number one, what do our people need from training? And number two, what is our training producing as far as experience and knowledge?
Yeah. Well, and it's one of the articles I did was like the six T's of fire service learning, and it kind of hits those same types of things. It's how are we actually training? Is it realistic, like you talk about? Are we going out and doing hose lays like in our head, you know, with a measuring stick? Or are we actually pulling lines off the engine? So I talk about training. I talk about testing. Is the testing actually lining up to what we really do? Like ladder testing for us for years, the ladder was on the ground. You know, I've never been to a structure fire yet where we pulled up, the ladder's laying in the middle of the street, you know? So how are we testing? And that's all the way from firefighter testing through officer testing, you know, is the simulators realistic? Are they, you know, really defining what we're trying to get out of them as a learning objective, right?
So and then you got to start talking about standards also, right? Having performance standards.
Right.
How long does it take us to do this? And what should it look like when it's done? And if you don't have standards, it's very difficult to get any kind of operational uniformity. Standards are essential. If you want A shift engine 1 to respond the same way as C shift engine 27, you got to have some standards in there. They got to play from the same sheet of music.
And that's going to build into your operational tempo for even your chief officer that's the IC. He's like, how long is it going to take for engine 1 to pull up, stretch a line, get the 360 done, force entry through the front door, you know? And so they're not like, this is taking too long. You know, it's all part of that. So yeah, we would go through that, the training, the testing, the teaching. Are we actually teaching relevant material? And then the three big ones I get into is that the triumph, the tragedy, the wins and the losses, and how you register that in your brain. And that's going to come up to my next thing here. And then the tragedies and the traditions. You know, so the traditions that we carry on goes back to the culture. But I want to talk about the triumphs and the tragedies. And that goes into one of the things that I always push pretty well. When I got trapped in that garage during that wildland fire, you talk about the Dr. Arwal that actually did the police officer shootout study.
On killing David Grossman.
Yeah. So that actually talks about, you know, sound, your auditory exclusion, all those types of things.
That's survival stress reaction. Yeah.
Yeah. And amazingly enough, when I was trapped in that garage, the four of us, when we got done, all four of us don't have the exact same story. We all registered it different. When you start talking about survival training, you have to understand that your brain is going to do stuff that you do not want it to do. And we saw all of that. And so for me, reading that in your book was really a cool connection for me.
So as trainers, right, and as officers, we can prepare our people for where their body is, their mind is going to go if they get in a situation where they think they may not get out of it, right? And so you better start taking care of business before, you know, your fine motor skills begin to decrease, your gross motor skills begin to increase. You get the deer in the headlights or the brain farts. Our people need to understand that that's coming. If you don't start to save yourself now, you may get to a point where you're not going to be able to.
Yeah, for sure. So, well, it's all great stuff. I'm going to turn it over to see if there's anybody else in the group. Anybody got any questions for Chief Thompson while you're here?
I wanted to add on to what you were talking about just there at the end. Georgia Smoke Diver Program, Justin Frazee is a Georgia Smoke Diver, and you got a couple others there too.
Well, I'm well aware.
You're not shy or unassuming, are they? But they, those Georgia Smoke Diver Program had one of their guys, one of the members was a couple of years ago, found himself in a position where he was trapped. I don't know, I can't remember the exact story, but he couldn't even reach his pass device. And so when he was trapped, he couldn't get out, and they couldn't find him. And so the smoke, but they found him right before his air ran out, and they saved him. So now they've come up with they came up with a drill or a prop to simulate that now. And it's pretty effective. They perfected it over time. Every class, for about five classes, they perfected that prop. And now the fellow that it happened to actually runs the drill, which is pretty amazing, because you get the real story from
it. Makes it very personal. We have the Denver drill, the Columbus drill with Mark Langvar, or Denver with Mark Langvar, John Nance and Columbus, you know, all those drills where we do exactly what you're saying. This is a close call. How can we get ourselves out of that through technique level training? And get that cognitive process working in our favor. Yeah, that's a great, great example.
Exactly.
Cool. Thanks, Judy. Mike, James, you got anything for Scott?
Yes, I do. Actually, I have a few questions, if you don't mind. Chief, you talked about surveying the public as far as what they thought the fire department would need to be doing and everything. What are some methods you have for I'm assuming you're continuing that up to today. It wasn't just a one-off, or was it just a one-time?
Well, I mean, not as formally. So I wish I would have done things a little differently. I still am with like the homeowners associations and the chambers. As far as going out to the general public, I don't do that anymore. But Mike Walker, who's the ops chief in Oklahoma City, who's a big fan of the book, he's doing that now up in Oklahoma City, and he's sending his people out. And he called me and said, Scott, if you had to do it over again, what would you do differently? I said, well, what would have made it much more scientific. I just was going out asking, what do you expect from your fire department? I didn't catch any demographics, and I didn't ask any real questions. He's asking stuff like, what level of risk do you want a firefighter to take to save your property? What level of risk do you expect a firefighter to take to save a loved one? And so if he continues that, I think that's going to produce a much better result. Cody Trestrail read it in the book, and he's gone out and done it. I think he did it with 40 people, and he actually videotaped it. So I would like to go out and do it again. I'm not still doing it regularly. I don't know if it's changed a whole lot, but that's something I thought about. But no, I'm not continuing it. I haven't done it again since. I should. I just haven't.
Okay. My department does a survey, sometimes like post-encounter survey kind of thing. And I was just looking for more ideas.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Sorry, James, you know, if that stuff from Cody is accessible where he went out and interviewed the people of the public?
You might reach out to him. He shows it in his class. He shows video clips from it in his class. Him and Andrea, from when she went with him and did it, but I don't know if he'd send it to you or not if you ask.
Yeah. Cool. All right. Sorry, James, go ahead.
I can check into it. No, that's fine. We talked a lot about culture here, and I'm just curious to know if you've ever either seen or heard of a pretty entrenched safety first culture evolving into a what you consider a smart first culture. What are a couple of critical steps along the way?
It all boils down to risk acceptance versus risk avoidance. Okay. Every one of us here that's on this panel will look at a fire event based on our experiences, right? But we all have a natural, either optimistic or pessimistic view on survivability. In other words, we can look at a building and half of us may say, oh, there's no way anybody could survive in that building. The other half of us will look at it, oh, that room right there, that's a searchable space. There's a chance. So to me, it really comes back to what your operational philosophy is and understanding what your level of risk avoidance is versus your risk acceptance. So that's one of the things I asked Gordon Graham about. I got to be very careful as I say this, because people immediately will tune me off and say they've lost credibility. But we don't use the word safe a lot in the colony. We use smart, and we define that as strategic, managed, aggressive, risk-regulated tactics. And so it's all about risk acceptance versus risk avoidance. And so that's a huge mindset switch. But my experience is a lot of fire chiefs, you know, that they're so worried about their pension. They're so worried about, you know, their career and their peers. And then they don't trust their people, their officers, to be trained to a level to be high performers. And so they just all of a sudden get into this huge risk avoidance phase. And that doesn't work in this occupation. We're never going to make this job safe. We'll make it safer. We'll make it less dangerous. But let's talk about the risks that are there and then talk about our capability. So to answer your question, I have seen it, but it's been through new leadership at the top. They came in and says, okay, this is the vision. This is why we exist. This is how we're going to train. This is going to help promote our people. And we're going to grasp this risk acceptance philosophy and become professional risk takers. And that's a cultural change, and it takes a while. I have seen it, but it's got to start at the top.
Okay.
I think even Bruno will, like today, he would talk about, yeah, I understand the we'll risk a little to save a little, we'll risk nothing to save nothing, we'll risk a lot to save a lot. But at the same time, I think Bruno even understands if we risk nothing, then we're going to save nothing. Like there's definitely going to be risk. You're not going to avoid risk completely in what you're doing, but it's got to be something where you're, like you said, you're smart about it. We're not just taking chances and rolling the dice, and it's calculating that risk. We've talked about it for years, but how do you calculate it?
And I'm a huge fan of Bruno Senior. Huge, huge. But I've changed that. I say we prepare a lot to save a lot, prepare a little to save a little. To me, it starts in the firehouse. And the reason that is the same thing as I said, all of us could be standing on the curb looking at the same building, but our experiences, we're all going to look at that differently. And some of us are going to have a more aggressive posture than others simply based on our experience and our past experiences. And when that starts to happen, now survivability becomes based on philosophy versus the situation. The smoke and the fire gases. It's the comfort level of the incident commander. I went to a fire here not long ago. One of our neighbors, it was a lightning strike. To me, it was a very minimal event. They committed interior to that building for four minutes in an attic fire in a single family. It was a lightweight, but not much fire at all before they pulled out and went defensive, right? That's a very high risk avoidance culture. And to me, our citizens are starting to notice that. And in my class, and I won't drag this on too long, but I think there's a lot that we can learn from active shooter events. You know, we just had one in Uvalde, and our citizens have told the police, this is how you will respond to an active shooter. What's going to be the catalyst in the fire service where our citizens are going to start to say, you will do vent enter search. You will search ahead of the line. You will make a commitment to saving my people and my property. If we don't do it, they're going to tell us to do it. If not, they'll find an alternative for what we do. But if you go back to Columbine, you remember how the police got beat up firing EMS at Columbine because we didn't go in, and then with Uvalde, the same thing. And our citizen said, that's enough. If you're a law enforcement officer and you got a weapon strapped to your waist, you're going to get in there and save my kid. The same thing applies to the fire service, I believe. Can't hear anybody.
I have a few more, unless other people have some too. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
You're muted.
Go ahead, James.
No, James, this is what it's all about. I mean, book club's trying to get you guys connected to these authors where you can ask those questions. Scott, as long as you're good with time, I'm good.
And just understand, a lot of this is kind of my opinion. There's an equal number of chiefs that'll disagree with everything I'm saying. Yeah. So take that at face value.
Was an interesting thing. I have a smaller bookshelf behind me, but there's lots of stacks everywhere. What's interesting is you hit on something in your book that I heard someplace else. I also listened to the Jocko podcast and a lot of his guests he has on there. And something struck me, I think a couple of years ago now, he had Jordan Peterson on and he was talking about his daughter riding a motorcycle and basically saying how he can't stop her from doing so. And so he wanted her to be competent on it. And what he basically said is there's nothing safer than competence. And that's something that resonated with me. And as I read your book about being smart first, I went, hey, there it is again. So it's just interesting how, I don't know if you'd ever heard that or not before, but how I get a lot of those ideas from different sources. And it was an interesting thing.
No, you're exactly right. We got to teach our people to run with scissors. That's really what we're teaching them to do. Right. To me, these chiefs that go around saying they're so safety conscious and all the things they're doing, yet they don't support training. In my opinion, training is the number one action step for creating safe operations. And a lot of fire service leaders miss that.
Well, even one of the things you talked about before, Chief, was we just probably 4 or 5 years ago went to dedicated truck crews and dedicated engine crews. And again, it changed the competence level to where now I see those truck guys pulling off some pretty crazy stuff. And it gets to the point, from an engine guy, I'm on the ground watching what they're doing. I'm like, that's cool. Before it was like, you're just a truckie. But now we're doing some pretty cool stuff with that.
But this is the fire. So you bring up a great point. This is the fire service, right? If a firefighter falls through a roof tonight, there's going to be a group of firefighters say, vertical vent is too dangerous, never should have been on the roof. Nobody's asking the question, when's the last time that crew went to the roof? Have they done it in the last 5 years? Was it a mistake of putting that crew on the roof? We put them in a position to fail and they did. I mean, that's how the fire service reacts to those kind of things. But I know in the Colony, Texas, in our little small system, if we go to the roof tonight, the ones going to the roof are the ones that go every fire. I don't have to worry about somebody going up that hasn't done it, hadn't been recently rehearsed in a year or more. That's the advantage to it.
Yeah, for sure.
And we're the only occupation that doesn't do that. I mean, imagine a baseball team or a football team. Before every game, they said, okay, whose turn is it to play quarterback tonight, right? They would not be successful.
Yeah. Cool. James, what else you got?
So something I've run into in my career a couple of times that I just was curious on how you'd handle it, how you keep your crew focused on this. And I'm going to call it the no good deed goes unpunished effect. It's kind of silly, but sometimes you go someplace and you help some people out and you put in this free smoke detector. And the next thing you know, the person next door goes, hey, where's my free smoke detector? And on it goes. It could be that, it could be other things. And I realized I just picked that one as a simple example. But the experience that I've had when that kind of thing has happened is it didn't go over very well with the crew. And it kind of had like a 10 or a 20 times effect of a demotivator kind of thing. And I'm just curious if this was a one-off that happened to happen in my area, or whether this was something that you've seen. And if you do see it, how would you sort of address it to try and keep your crew focused on, no, this is really the right thing. We got to keep doing this kind of stuff.
Be honest with you, I don't have any experience with that. In the six organizations that I belong to, I've never noticed that of being an issue. So I'm sorry, I can't.
Okay.
I can't comment intelligently to that situation.
All right. I'm glad to hear that, because I'm hoping it's isolated. I think that's it for me.
Great questions. Thank you for asking.
Thank you for coming on, Chief. I appreciate it, your message. Oh. I've listened to your podcast and your book and appreciate it.
Well, thank you.
Mike, anything today?
Sure. Start off by saying thanks very much for everything, Chief. Whether it's the books, it's the presentations, it's the training, it's whatever. It's phenomenal stuff.
Thank you,
the
Mike.
Big question that I would have for you is, when can we like clone you and put you in the majority of fire departments around the country? So,
Mike, I don't have it all figured out, you know, and I've got to say that we got a lot of issues and I got a lot of things I struggle with. You know, my whole belief is simply that, you know, firefighters are great, great people. And if you trust them and you train them and you encourage them and you support them, they're going to do great things. And I think the only thing that's a little different for me than maybe a few others is seeing the good in firefighters instead of trying to focus on all the bad things that happen. I mean, you know, this is a great, great thing, but thank you. But I got a lot of issues and my guys will be the first to tell you it's not Disneyland here.
It's as we have the saying in the fire service, no matter where you go, it's a circus. It's just different clowns and acts. So yeah, we all know that all too well. So
yes, sir.
Question for you, if you could elaborate potentially, it's something that I definitely took some bits and pieces, but if you could potentially elaborate a little bit more on your professional development program and kind of specifically like some more details, if you could, on how that works or how that's progressing or how that's changed since you took over.
So I'm going to contradict every leadership book that's ever been written. Okay. If you ask any student of leadership, what's the most important thing? What's the most important thing in your organization? They're going to say people, right? Now, people are our greatest asset. I agree with that. But to me, the most important thing in any organization is the culture. And here's why I say that, is we can go out and hire the best firefighters on the planet. But if we bring them into an unhealthy or toxic culture, what are they going to be in 6 months, right? They're going to be. So I really spent my first 14 years really focusing on a culture because I wanted to create an environment where our people could be successful and thrive. And now I'm starting to make a shift towards the individuals. And I think the culture has taken enough roots to where I don't have to pay as much attention to it. So we're just really getting into this. I tasked the Colony Fire Department leadership team with saying, I want us to create a world-class officer success program. And we're working on that right now. We're calling it Trumpets 1 and 2, but it's still very much in the works. But what something interesting happened our last promotional process. Two of my very respected captains came to me and said, Chief, we would request a process that really focuses on our core values of duty, respect, integrity. So that told, and they went out and they polled the organization. And so they're saying those are really, if those are our core values, let's train to our core values. So some of the things we're going to include, we're going to talk about emotional intelligence. We're going to talk about managing maturity. We're going to talk about entitlement. We're going to talk about understanding the culture and the culture the role that the culture plays and how we can influence the culture. So, you know, those are a lot of things that we're working on. And I'll be honest with you, we're not kind of following NFPA or any of those CAM programs. We're trying to really look at ourselves and say, what do we want our officers? What do we want the mindset to be? We're not trying to change the person. We're trying to create a mindset that will allow our members to thrive. And so, you know, I hope to get Trumpets 1 done. We're going to do Trumpets 1 in odd number of years, Trumpets 2 in even number of years. And hopefully we're going to get Trumpets 1 done here pretty quick. And we're doing it. If a lot of people call them bugles, the stuff right. in our call, but that's where Trumpets 1 and Trumpet, just for anybody who's listening. Right. And it kind of comes from ladders from FDNY. So, but we're working on that right now. We're doing captains camps. That's the big thing. We just got done with one of those where we did the Colony Project too. And we kind of said, what do we want to look like in the next 7 to 10 years? But going forward, the rest of my time in the Colony Fire Department is going to be spent on individual, personal, and professional development. We're not done with it yet.
Okay. And if you go to like Steve Jobs, who of course said, you know, we hire the smart people and listen to them. And I'm wondering if that's kind of not part of your success is your hiring process. Because I think a lot of departments struggle because they don't necessarily hire the right people and then try to change them into the right people. So could you talk a little bit about your hiring process?
That's a great question. And you know, I think a majority of the American Fire Service right now is suffering from recruitment and retention. It's hard to get good people and keep them. And when I talk to those fire chiefs, the first thing I say is, well, why would somebody want to work for your organization? Now, think about that. If I belong to an organization and I don't have an immediate response, when I advertise, what am I advertising? If I don't know what my organization has to offer, what am I putting out there to attract people? Because we have a very involved training culture, and we have this engine and truck deployment model, and we have single role paramedics and all these other things, we're able to put information out that attracts a very specific type of person. Right. And what we're doing, and maybe some will say this is not professional practice, but we're filling the voids that they're not getting in their organization. We're giving them something that they're not getting in their organization. But all of this starts with that vision of success. If I can't sit down as a fire chief, as an ops chief, and articulate what success looks like, what am I chasing every day? I believe more in the concept of let's hire people for their attitude and their passion, and we'll train them to be firemen. But let's make sure they have a mindset and they're okay with training. They understand the value of training. It's not just unnecessary work or labor. It's part of the survival process. And so all those things play into it. But if you can't even come up with a short list of why people would want to work for you other than it's a job and what we pay, you don't have any control of the type of people that are coming into your organization. So you take what you get and you hope you get some good ones, but you're going to get some bad ones. That's right. My opinion, but it's held pretty true in our organization.
I would say once again that I believe probably a huge part of your success has been your hiring. And if you listen to the Fortune 500 companies, that's exactly what they'll tell you. You know, we have to find the right people to match our organizations. If not, we're trying to change people. And ultimately, either A, the changes don't take effect, or that's where your time, effort, and energy goes. And it's not on just having people that, like you said, you know, like you said, just support me and get out of the way, you know, and I'll do the right things and I'll do the good things. But you have to have the right people to start off with that.
Easier to change the work environment than it is to change each individual. We don't even into that.
I think that's a great point you make too about you have that option to say, this is a role that you want to fit. We have that for you, rather than we're going to try to make you a jack of all trades, which a lot of other people have brought up just has huge implications, because do you want a jack of all trades on your fire ground or do you want a master? You know, and going back to a previous comment, my opinion, the biggest risk or hazard on the fire ground is an incompetent firefighter. So, you know, so if you want to be safe, be competent. Competency equals safety. So,
this is a huge hypocrisy. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No,
you're a huge hypocrisy in the fire service. But, you know, these chiefs will go around and say, fires are down. We need to focus more on EMS. EMS is our bread and butter. Do any of y'all run ambulances in your organization? Okay, right.
Well, interestingly, the one that I just retired from, we're split. So our firefighters are firefighters and our EMS are EMS, because we recognize what I believe is that valid issue of we have people that want to ride fire trucks. We have people that want to ride ambulances. They're not the same people. So don't try to, right. So,
and so if I'm going to say EMS is the most important thing to do, who do we generally put on our ambulances? The most junior person, right? It's almost like a punishment. And so the most important thing we do, we have our least experienced people doing it. Make sense out of that.
Right.
Great points, Mike. Great points.
No, thank you very much. Appreciate it. And please keep up the outstanding work. It's greatly needed and greatly appreciated. So
thank you very much.
Yep.
All right. Well, once again, a very successful book club meeting. I think we pounded Scott enough, hitting some questions really hard. And I always enjoy bringing on these authors because we can get that expansion on the books. The books is a great start, but being able to ask literally the author of the book, their insight, I think is really huge. So Chief, thank you again for taking time out of your day. I know that we had to reschedule this a couple of times. I finally found somebody in the fire service that's busier than I am. It is you.
I don't know about that, but thank you very much. It was an honor, and this was a lot of fun. So best of luck. And if I can do anything for any of you, you can email me at scott@fireserviceleadership.com, and I'll help you any way I can. I always say I'm a little bit of a procrastinator, so don't be afraid to nag me because I am going a million different directions. But hope to keep in touch with you guys and look forward to maybe running into you on the road, and just keep doing great things.
Awesome. Thank you, sir.
We'll see you at FDIC, hopefully.
You bet. All right. Bye-bye. Bye.